recording. We're going to go ahead and get started this morning. So good morning to everyone. Welcome to our first North Carolina Commercial Blackberry and Raspberry Grower Association Specialist Zoom call. Most of you probably know me, but in case you don't, I'm Karen Blado, and I'm the vegetable and small fruit agent up in Henderson County in the mountains. And also on the call, I saw Daniel Shires this year. He is an area agent with Extension in Cleveland County, and he helps manage your association. So I want to make sure to introduce him there. So as you guys probably saw in the letter that went out to you, when the board met a month ago, they decided in lieu of the coronavirus that the annual meeting, the in-person annual meeting, would be pushed back till May. Not sure what date yet, but because it's being pushed back, they thought these monthly specialist updates would be really helpful. And so this is our first one. So we're going to kick it off today with two specialists. We have Dr. Gina Fernandez. Of course, you guys know her. She's our Caneberry Specialist and Breeder. And we also have Dr. Tom Kahn. He is actually the Southeast Apple Research Specialist. And now he's a Blackberry researcher as well. So we're super thrilled to have Tom here today. So during the presentation portion, I'm gonna ask you guys to stay on mute, and then we'll open it up at the end for questions and you can unmute then. If you have questions, you can also put them in the chat box and I can ask them of the speakers as well. So this is definitely supposed to be interactive. At the end, we'll can open it up and just have, you know, conversations and dialogue. So I'm gonna turn it over to you, Gina, and let you get started first.
Sure, thanks, Karen. So let me share my screen. Are you seeing a bunch of raspberries in a hand?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to talk about two things today, and then we have an hour or a little bit less than an hour now too. So I'm going to kind of zoom through what my topics, and then Tom has a talk to talk about some of the stuff that we've been doing or he's been doing with me or whatever up in the mountains. And then also we have Tom has a little survey. So I'm going to talk first about the Caneberry Breeding Program, what's sort of the status of it is, and then a new project that we're doing with some of the USDA Oregon germplasm, some of the advanced or the selections and cultivars that they have released from that program. So a little bit of a breeding update here. Just want to give you some information what's out there already. So Vaughn, the floricane fruiting blackberry, sold about, it's a commercial blackberry that does well for growers in this part of the country. We sold about 34,000 plants last year. You know, we're not big as the Arkansas stuff, but we still are doing pretty good there, I think. Nantahala red raspberry, it's a primacane fruiting red raspberry. It's doing well in the homeowner market. So it sells through Gurney's catalogs and some of those other outlets right there for quite a bit of money. I saw this year they're selling them for $17 a plant. And we have sold 50,000 of them last year. So it's catching on in the homeowner's market. As of 2016, when I took over the strawberry breeding program, I was told to cut back on caneberry stuff. So we haven't made any new crosses or new seedlings, but fortunately I had a bunch of stuff in the queue that we had kept going through the system. So we are still not as active as we were before, but we do have a lot of material that has made it through the system. Right now we have about 20 selections that need additional evaluation that are looking good. And I can talk about those in more in depth here in a minute. And the focus is mostly raspberry. It's hard to compete with that University of Arkansas breeding program. They have a small army there, but we are working on raspberries, primacane fruiting, red conical berries for fresh market, and some that are more heat tolerant than stuff that is released from other programs. And also do have a small project with pairwise plants. It's a new gene editing plant in Durham. And we are training a master's student on that. It's a collaborative project with Cornell, USDA, and University of Arkansas in British Columbia berry breeding. and it has lots of bioinformatic information, genomic information, and we're doing a field trial with them as well. But we're not going to be talking about that, just kind of let you know what's going on with that. So currently, most of the breeding activity is in the Piedmont Research Station in Salisbury. You can see right here, it's sort of centrally located there. We previously had some, do you see my arrow? Had some test trials up in the mountains, up in Laurel Springs, and also at the research station in Mills River, and down in the Sand Hills as well. So we have consolidated all that that work right now into at the Piedmont Research Station, and that's where we are focused right now. Although we might be doing a little bit more up in the mountains in the coming years or so with some funding. We also have a couple other Caneberry projects. Like I mentioned before, we're working at the Mountain Horticulture Crop Research and Extension Center, probably doing a variety trial funded sponsored program with North Bay, and then starting a long cane project with Lewis Farm down in the southeastern part of the state too. So some stuff on the horizon there that are exciting.
Gene.
All right. Yes, Cal?
Have you done anything with Vaughn and Nantahala as long canes yet?
Have not.
Has Whitney got them in her program?
She does. She does, yep. So we can talk about that if you want. Okay. Yeah. So some of the advanced material that we have in the breeding program there. So we do have one floricane fruiting blackberry, NC740. It's in tissue culture right now. So about last year, about this time, I determined that it's worth trialing a little bit more. So we're cleaning it up. It's at the NPRU. And you can see those plants right there. They've got, you know, four meristems, and it's actually, this is a slide that was from January or December. So they're multiplying and increasing those. So those should be available. They said maybe in the fall for some on-farm trials and for nurseries if we want to start propagating them on a commercial scale. There's three raspberries, NC745, a primacane fruiting red raspberry, 760, a primacane fruiting red raspberry, and a 772, they're all primacane fruiting red raspberries. They didn't make it into tissue culture. They are harder to get into tissue culture, but they are at the NPRU, and they're going to continue to try to get them in. And then we also have a primacane fruiting yellow raspberry. It's got great vigor for a yellow raspberry. And I'll show you a little bit more about each one of those coming up here too. So this past summer, I took this picture of NC740. Let me see if I can get a video of it going here. It's the floricane fruiting blackberry. It's thornless. It's got Vaughn as one of its parents and one of the ORUS 2816-3. So it is related to Galaxy. It's a sibling of Galaxy. So it's got, you know, that the Pacific Northwest background is in addition to Vaughn, but this background has actually got a lot of Eastern genetics in it as well. We selected a 2014. Flavor was very good. It has medium size in this kind of lonely plot, early to mid-season, and it seems like a clean plant like Vaughn is. So let me just show you this real quick.
Here's NC748, thornless floricane fruiting blackberry in a neglected plot. So here we can see it's got decent front load, decent size. I think this could probably size up if we paid a little bit of attention to it. Good crop load right here. And see the primacanes coming up out of the canopy. NC740.
So that's just a quick little glimpse of it, what it looked like this summer. And like I said, it's in a plot that doesn't have a whole lot of care to it. So Vaughn in an adjacent plot looks similar to it as well. So we're keeping an eye on that one.
Here's NC740.
Oh, keep going. 745 is the other red raspberry. It's primacane fruiting, vigorous, long laterals. The berry size, we took the berry size this summer and not really impressed with it, so it might drop out of the program, but this is one of the ones that we did send to the NPRU. We'll be keeping an eye on it for another summer or so. 760 is another primacane fruiting red raspberry. It's semi-long conical, and this summer, for some reason, I didn't take good pictures of fruit, and we'll be working on that this next summer. Very good appearance, decent berry size for this location, and very high soluble solids, 13.8, which is nice and sweet. So this one we'll be keeping an eye on as well. This is 772. This is an unusual one. If you can look at this one compared to some of the other plots, you can see where the plot begins and ends here. So this is the beginning of the plot. That's the end of the plot. It's a semi-dwarf type. It's got mandarin in its background, so it's heat tolerant. It's early and late, so it's primocane fruiting, and it goes on for a long time. We think that this one might be nice in the homeowner market, like, you know, something like a nantahala. It's semi-dwarf and it's got decent soluble solids. Berry size isn't good, but for homeowners, they don't really care. So that one is out there as well. And then we have 773. It's this primocane fruiting yellow. For a yellow, it's doing really well in this location. So that's why we advanced it. It's thornless also, which is really unusual to have a raspberry that's thornless. Sometimes they have thorns kind of halfway down the cane. Vigor is good for this location. Berry size isn't great, but the soluble solids is. So that's, you know, one of the ones that we're keeping an eye on. And those are the ones that we have, you know, in the advanced kind of, in our list of the most advanced and that are at the NPRU. We're watching all these other ones here, mostly primocane fruiting reds, but they have various traits. They were selected mostly in the Sandhills or the Piedmont Research Station. So we feel like they have a little bit more heat tolerance if they've survived the initial screening through the seedling stage and then also through the selection stage. We feel like they're doing pretty well as far as being adapted. Stuff that was selected up in the mountains probably won't do as well down in the Piedmont location, but if we put them back up in the mountains, we think they have a good chance of doing quite well. You can just see some of the sizes and shapes and colors of some of the materials right there. So we're going to be looking at these or so in the next year or two and collecting some more data on them and probably putting more of them in tissue culture. So we need to get some more yield data on those plots. I have limited capacity as far as our people to help harvest because of this. The Piedmont location is also one where we have some of the strawberry breeding. So I suck up a lot of their resources, but I was able to hire a person full-time last summer and she will be returning this summer. So we hopefully will be able to gear up a little bit and take some more data on a weekly basis, on a daily basis in these plots. We'll get some more of these in, you know, after next summer. I think we'll look at some of these again and try to get some more of them into tissue culture. And then if we can, we'll get them into replicated trials. And that's going to be a bit of a negotiation with the research trials, maybe some on-farm trials, if you all are interested in putting some of these on your trial, your farms. But we would need data back. It's not just observational things. So, but we can talk about that at some point. So that's about it for the raspberry section. I don't know if anybody has a quick question about anything there. And then I want to talk about another project real quick that we're doing with blackberries and with the USDA program.
Does anyone have a question that they want to ask right now? Don't think all right. So, Gina.
We'll keep moving on then. Okay. So this past year, as everybody knows, we lost a great blackberry breeder, Chad Finn. And I have been trialing some of his material at the Piedmont Research Stations for years. And most of the stuff that he sends me, I tell him, I've told him all the time that, you know, it's Chad, they're just ugly. They're not adapted. But there were occasional ones that he had developed that has some of this Eastern germplasm or, you know, the Eastern genetics in it that did do well. And one of them is actually one of the ones that he named and released. So this past year, I thought, well, let's see if we can get some of that stuff trialed. There's a couple, I know Cal's tried some of this stuff and Chuck Geyer up in Virginia had tried some of this stuff, but nothing really caught on yet. And people aren't hearing about it. So I want to try to get this material out there and see how it does, because it's in all the material that he sends me every year, it's the stuff that does the best, at least the ones that we're going to trial here. So we have these, it was funded, we got some money from the Southern Region Small Fruit Consortium. I contacted some growers in North Carolina, South Carolina, and Virginia. Chuck Geyer's up in Virginia. We have Ethan Leinberger and Wayne Mitchum trialing in Western North Carolina. Tom O'Brien in Central. And if you, one of you guys, I see a couple of you guys down in the Eastern part of the state are online too. If you're interested, contact me afterwards. And I think we can probably squeeze out another trial with the funds down in this location as well. And then Bob Hall will be trialing with them in South Carolina. We are trialing, what we have arranged is to get some funds to buy plants, 50 plants of five different cultivars, Galaxy, Twilight, Eclipse, and then for a check, we'll have Vaughn and Wachita in there as well. And we'll buy these plants, ship them to you. We have a little protocol that we'll send as well. And we don't require you to take yield, but we want some feedback where you actually look at the plants and tell us how they do compare to one another. So we'll ship out those five different cultivars. There's a couple of numbered ones on the horizon, or US 4670-1, that's floricane fruiting. I don't think we can get the paperwork together for that for this year, but we can probably do something next year. And he also has a couple of primacane fruiting that I think are worth looking at as well. So we might be talking about another trial in the future. So just a little bit about the ones that we'll be shipping out. Galaxy is tested as ORSU2711. It's thornless, semi-erect. 75% of the genetics are Eastern. That means it's stuff that we have in the Eastern United States. Fairly good yield according to them. The berry size is 7.5 grams, which is not huge, but not bad. Round, glossy, you can see pictures of them there. Ripens late July, early August in the Pacific Northwest with Loch Ness and before Triple Crown. So that kind of gives you some idea if you have ever grown those other cultivars. Eclipse, and this is the Celestial series, so you'll notice these names kind of have a theme. This is the one that actually I have tried at the Piedmont Research Station, and I always told Chad, if this one, it just looks amazing. It's a thornless, semi-erect as well. Again, the 75% the Eastern genetics. It has Navajo in its background, so you can, familiar with that variety. Medium to large yields, medium size, a little bit smaller than the Galaxy. Ripens about the same time as well, and plants are available, not can be available. And then Twilight is the third one in that series. It's the thornless semi-erect. And again, I guess it's 75% Eastern. I forgot to put that one in there. This has got the largest fruit according to their data, and a crisp texture, excellent flavor. It's ripens with or slightly later than Loch Ness, which nobody grows here, I don't think anymore, but before Triple Crown and Chester. So I'm not sure if any of these are gonna fit exactly into that late season. Because things actually shift when you plant them here as well. So we'll see how those do. And I think because we have those different locations, we'll have an idea when they ripen, and we'll be able to compare it to those two other standards there. They have compared all of those cultivars with other cultivars in storage studies, and they all do better than Triple Crown and Chester Thornless, which isn't hard to do, but they all three of them did that. So this is just an example. This is Twilight versus Triple Crown. You can see there you can see here that this is Twilight, looks much better than Triple Crown, and Twilight versus Chester Thornless too. So an improvement over those older varieties that just don't do well for us in commercial setting anyways. And I think that's about it. I just wanted to say thank you to everybody, the research stations, the department, Southern Region Small Fruit Consortium for funding this, and to Phylotech too. So they're a new plant propagation tissue culture company in Eastern North Carolina. They produce all their plants from tissue culture, and they gave us a discount on these plants. So that was helpful for us, and we appreciate them for doing that for us. So that's all I got here as far as breeding updates. If anybody has any questions, you can contact me and I will be happy to answer them, or answer them now too if we got a minute or two.
Yeah, we do. If folks have questions, you can go ahead and unmute and ask Gina.
And I think Karen did mention too that all of these are going to, these talks are going to go up on online too, on the blog, Team Rubus blog, and then it'll also go to the extension website as well, the Rubus portal on the NC State Cooperative Extension website.
Yeah, we'll post the recordings, especially if you guys want to go back and look at